Thanks a lot for the organizers for inviting me here. And I'm going to tell you about this revolution, of which we are celebrating an anniversary this year. It's been 10 years since the first breakthrough came up. Very few of you may have heard this talk before because I've given it around and even here in Paris about half a year ago, but ignoring those people, let's start. So, okay, so computational geometry will not be mentioned here almost at all. I'm mainly talking about combinatorial geometry, and Paul Erdős is responsible for most of this area and for the main problem that has started this so-called revolution. At least this is how I think about it. So, in his own words, one of the questions in geometry that he cherished the most was the question about distinct distances. It's actually, he formulated two problems, one of distinct distances and one of repeated distances, but the distinct distances seem to be a harder one. Actually, it's the other way around, as it turns out now, but still, the question is, if you have a set of n points in the plane, you want a lower bound that will hold for any such set on the number of distinct distances that can be attained between its points. And so he formulated this question and the question of repeated distances, which is, again, you have a set of points and you want an upper bound on the maximum number of times that the same distance can be attained between pairs of the points. So Erdős noticed in 1946 that if you take the integer lattice square root n by square root n, you get n over square root log n distinct distances, and he conjectured that this is the smallest possible number that you can get. So no matter how your points are arranged, you'll always get at least that many distinct distances. This is just an illustration where this is not the lattice, but almost the lattice, and here too you have relatively few distinct distances, but still, of course, if the points are in general position, you will get and choose two distinct distances, but you allow the points to be placed in S degenerate, so to speak, way as possible, and you still want to argue that you'll get at least that many distinct distances. The problem was very difficult. It's still not 100% solved yet, but the way we understand it now, it's almost solved in a minute. And in the classical, more combinatorial, discrete way of looking at things, more geometric, so to speak, the best people could get was this n to the point 6, 8 something. And the problem was kind of stuck. Now, the other hero, I'm showing only two photos, this is the second one, the person who was like the prophet or the visionary of the whole development, who unfortunately died 3 months before it all started, was Gyuri Elekes, who had all the ideas kind of put together, but he couldn't prove what he really needed to prove in order to get the things going. So you'll see his name mentioned quite a bit in the talk. Excuse me. So he was thinking about the problem for a long time, and around 2000 he came up with a plan, with a program of how to solve the problem. He formulated certain conjectures which he couldn't prove. He passed them to me. And again, nobody could do anything, not just to me, to many people. And at the end, he passed away, was a heavy smoker, unfortunately. Still, the problem kind of got stuck. And then the heroes, so to speak, whose names are signed on the important papers are Larry Guth and Nets Hawk Katz, who had two papers where they started this, what I call a revolution. The first one was the simpler, and it solved a different problem called the joints conjecture, the joint problem. And the problem says the following. It is related to the main development that I want to mention. You have n lines in three dimensions, and you call a point a joint if it is incident to at least three non-coplanar lines from your set. It can be incident to many other lines, but if there are three lines incident to it that are non-coplanar, then it is a joint. And a very simple construction of a grid, root n by root n by root n, you have roughly, and you look at all the lines of the grid, roughly 3n of them, and the number of vertices of the grid will be square root n cubed, n to the 3 half, and each one of them is a joint because it has three lines pointing in the different coordinate directions, so non-coplanar. And the conjecture was that this is a tight bound. So you cannot get more than n to the 3 half, order of n to the 3 half joints for n lines. And their first result of Guth and Katz, the strange title of the paper, Algebraic Methods in Discrete Analogs of the Kakeya Problem, because they came up from the world of harmonic analysis Kakeya problem, and there was some connection between that problem and incidence geometry, which I will not mention the connection, but there is such a connection. That's why they got interested in this. And they found a solution by using algebraic methods. The algebraic methods for the first solution were kind of simpler, but still the idea was to use polynomials, vanishing at points, various other tricks for algebraic geometry and plane algebra. That was a new idea in the business. In retrospect, their proof was not difficult, but it was kind of a little complicated, got simplified, got generalized to any dimension. So even in D dimensions, you can have joints, you have set of lines, still lines, and a point is a joint if it is incident to D lines that are kind of not all in a common hyperplane, and then the bound gets smaller as D increases, n to the D over D minus 1. There are two almost identical proofs that came up more or less at the same day. And then, by way of history, I kind of, after the result, I thought that it could apply to the distinct distance problem. I wrote it out, adding Elekesh as a co-author, and Guth and Katz saw these ideas and developed them into their second breakthrough paper, where they showed that the number of distinct distances in the plane is always at least n over log n. So the upper bound was n over square root log n, this is n over log n, but compared with the agony that it took in studying this problem in the past, this is considered an almost solution. Still, nobody has managed to close this gap in the past 10 years. Okay. Just a little bit about, because I want to mention some new developments too, just a little bit about the idea about Elekesh program and how they solved it. So Elekesh's idea was to look at rigid motions in the plane, which he and we will call rotations, because each one of them is a rotation around some point unless it is a pure translation. They have 3 degrees of freedom, so we can think about rotations as represented as points in 3 dimensions. And rotations are related because if I give you 2 pairs of points that have the same distance between them, this is equivalent to the existence of a rotation that maps, so the pairs are A, B, and A prime, B prime, so it is equivalent to the existence of a rotation that maps A to A prime and B to B prime, if and only if. So by studying the pattern and the number of such rotations, Elekesh had a plan how to get from it, using essentially the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, how to get from it a lower bound on the number of distinct distances. I will not go into all this into the algebra, but his main idea was, so you have such a pair of pairs, and you look at one point here and one point here, and you ask, what are all the rotations that take a to a prime? And that is a set with just one degree of freedom, because after you map a to a prime, all you can do is rotate around that point. So it is a curve in three dimensions, and with some care, you can even make it a line if you use the right parameterization. So every pair of points in the set induce a line, and if A, B, and A prime, B prime are the same distance, then the line A, A prime, and the line B, B prime will meet, will touch each other at the rotation where that maps A to A prime and B to B prime. And so using Cauchy-Schwarz and other very simple calculations, really simple, but I will not mention them here, Elkesh came up with the following main conjecture. So consider K-rich rotations. These are rotations that map at least K points from your set to K other points, at least. So if you think about them as points in three dimensions, these are points that are incident to at least K lines of your lines of the form HAB, or HAA prime. So a rotation of with multiplicity 3 will map a triangle to another triangle. And his conjecture was that the number of such K-rich rotations in a set of capital N lines in three dimensions will be the number of lines to the 3 half divided by K square. So in our case, we have n square, a little n square lines. So this would be n cubed divided by k squared. Once you prove this conjecture and you follow his program, you get the lower bound n over log n. So this was already known, but no one knew how to solve this conjecture. So essentially, both the joints problem and the distinct distance problem are questions about incidences between points and lines in three dimensions. For the joints, it is clear. And here, using Elkesh transformation, we also get such a thing. And Guth and Katz solved this problem using algebraic ideas. The joints problem is not such a quote-unquote big problem as the distinct distances, but still, it took quite a long time with very little success to do nothing about it. The distinct distances kind of 60 something years until they managed to solve it. And these new algebraic ideas, which I will mention shortly, turned out to be useful for many other problems, both in incidence geometry and in other problems that seems totally unrelated. But since it all boils down to incidences, let's kind of spend a few slides on what incidences are, just to be on the same page. So incidences are usually between points and some other things. The simplest thing would be lines. And the simplest setup would be in the plane. So in this very basic problem, we have m points and n lines in the plane. And we want to count the number of pairs, point lines, so that the point lies on the line. This is an incidence. The trivial upper bound is m times n, but if the points and the lines are distinct, the feeling is that it should be smaller. And let's write IPL for the number of incidences between the points of P and the lines in L. And let's write IMN for the maximum such number. So how many incidences can we have between M points and N lines, presumably in very degenerate situations? And the breakthrough that started, I mean, there were previous works on incidences, but the you know, decisive bound on this very special case is due to Semeredi and Trotter, who showed in 83 the upper bound that it is of the order M to the 2/3, N to the 2/3. plus m plus n. You need this plus m plus n because if m is much smaller than n or n is much smaller than n, the bound with the term with exponents is meaningless. And you need the linear terms. And it's tight. There are various constructions noted by many people. Not many, but quite a few. Okay, a commercial slide that tries to motivate why incidences are interesting. And there are all kinds of reasons. Many problems are reduced to incidences. This Kakeya question that somehow got connected to incidences is another motivation. You brought me here to tell you about incidences for yet another reason, I assume. But let's take the view that incidences are at least interesting, if not important. I think they are important too. So incidences between points and lines are the very in the plane are very the very basic special case, and you can think about generalizations as much as you like. And people did think about such generalizations. For example, incidences between points and circles, or points and other curves in the plane, incidences between points and lines in three dimensions, which is what Guth and Katz have studied, points and curves, points and surfaces, higher dimensions. There is no end to the number of problems that you can invent. In almost all of them, with very few exceptions, there are no known tight bounds. We have upper bounds and lower bounds, and there are gaps, which we don't know yet how to close. And because the distinct distance problem that everybody was so much excited about got translated into questions about incidences, it got an extra boost. And the interesting thing to notice is that the question in three dimensions is interesting only if you make sure that not all your points and lines lie in a common plane. Because if they all lie in a common plane, you get the same Reddit-Rotter bound. There's nothing better that you can do. You somehow need to twist the lines into, quote unquote, truly three-dimensional position. In particular, you don't want to see too many lines lying in a common plane, because otherwise the three-dimensionality is meaningless. So the main new technique of Guth and Katz was this third bullet polynomial partitioning. But there are all kinds of other tricks from algebraic geometry, differential geometry, algebraic topology. There are all kinds of new domains from which ideas came into the play. And some of the basic results on which the new developments are based go back to the 19th century. At the time that algebraic geometry used to be more geometry than algebraic, and there are very beautiful results, the Cayley-Salmon theorem and others, I'll mention them briefly, that have been used in the analysis. Okay. So what Guth and Katz have shown, they actually haven't quite shown that, but that's somehow how I like to think about it, and it's immediately follows from their work, their second paper, is that the number of incidences between m points and n lines in three dimensions is m to the 1/2 n to the 3/4 plus m plus n, which is better than the m to the 2/3 n to the 2/3 of Semeradi and Trotter if you work out the exponents. But that holds provided that no plane contains more than order of square root n lines. So this is how you avoid the planarity. You make the things truly three-dimensional. You can write the bounds if you assume that every plane contains at most S lines. You get a slightly different bound, but anyway. Their main technique, as I said, was to use this new idea of polynomial partition, which is really the revolutionary trick here. And the result says the following, that if you have n points, in d dimensions, and you want to break them into sets of size n over t, at most n over t, then you can do it with a polynomial, with a real polynomial whose degree is of the order of t to the 1 over b, in the sense that if you draw the zero set, z of f of the polynomial, it splits space into connected components. The complement of the zero set consists of connected components, and each connected component will contain at most n over t points. You have no idea how many points will lie on the zero set. Maybe all of them will, if you are unlucky or lucky. But each open connected cell of the complement will contain more roughly the same number of points. The number of connected components is as follows from standard things in algebraic geometry, also of the order of t. And this is obtained by repeated applications of something called the polynomial ham sandwich cut, going back to 1942. The proof at the end is not so difficult once you understand the trick. Okay, so this might be how it looks like. The blue is the zero set of the polynomial. And here, somehow, every connected component contains at most 2 points. Many points may lie on the zero set. And actually, you can, if you forget the parameter t and just talk about the degree d, so if I tell you the degree d of the polynomial, then, and you, again, you have n points in little d dimensions, you can construct such a polynomial of degree at most d, and you look at each connected component of the complement of the zero set, and each of such components will contain at most n over d to the d points. 5 years later, Larry Guth came up with a generalization where your data doesn't consist of points, but of constant degree algebraic varieties, say lines or spheres or whatever. And you get essentially the same result, except that now each cell that not contains, but is crossed by at most n over d to the d minus k. This is the right bound on average. For example, when k is 1, 4 lines, and you are in 3 dimension, little d is 3, so every cell will be crossed by n over d square lines. And if you think about it, this is the average value that you will expect, but Guth's bound makes sure that it happens everywhere. Every cell is crossed by only that many lines. And it can be generalized to higher dimensional varieties. Okay, so here again, it is one of the connected components of the complement, and it is crossed by only 3 lines in this example. Okay, so polynomial partitioning, kind of, let me skip over the slides except for the last line, that this is really the major new idea in all this development. So let's assume we have the polynomial partition. I'm not going to tell you how to prove it. Again, it's just a survey, so to speak. But suppose you have it. How do you get the bound? How do you prove Guth and Katz upper bound? Well, you choose a degree d, which we have to choose later, and you apply the combined version of the original Guth-Katz and the revised, the extended Guth bound. So you partition 3 dimensions into d cube cells, and each cell will contain m over d cube of your points and will be crossed by n over d square of the lines. And now you need a trivial upper bound for the number of incidences within each cell, which for points and lines is simply the number of points square plus the number of lines. It's very simple because if a point p lies on a line l, you just take another point q on the line and charge the incidence to the pair pq. The charging is unique because pq determines at most 1 line. So the number of incidences is at most the square or order of the square of the number of points, except that you may have lines that contain only 1 point, so you cannot charge it to a second point, then you get the extra term number of lines. So this is the trivial upper bound. you just substitute m over d cube and n over d square. You get the bound there and there. And now you multiply by the number of cells, cancel out, and this is what you get. Now, if you just choose the right d to minimize, to balance the two terms, which happens to be that term, you get m to the 1 half n to the 3 quarters. So it seems like you are done, but the problems only begin because we have ignored the points that lie on the zero set. And even Hamlet says that we have to ask where the point lies, and the points that lie on the zero set, we have no control over them. We don't know how many. Maybe all the points lie there. And then we have to do something else to bound the number of incidences on the zero set. So the lines either cross the zero set or are contained in the zero set. If they cross the zero set, polynomial of degree d, they cross it in only d points. Each line contributes d incidences, n times d. We already had the bound n times d on a previous slide. Trivial. What happens if the lines are fully contained in the zero set? So we have an algebraic surface, a variety of degree d. It contains points and lines. What do we do? Well, the question is, can an algebraic variety contain lines, contain many lines? So it can. And the simplest way in which it can do it, and essentially the only way in which it can contain many lines, is if it is a ruled surface. A surface, many ways to define it, essentially it's the union of lines, the generator lines that kind of sweep the surface. There are two classical examples of quadratic surfaces which are doubly ruled. Each point has two lines passing through it and fully contained. One is the hyperboloid of one sheet shown here, and the other one is the hyperbolic paraboloid, something like z equal xy. But this Cayley-Salmon theorem from the 19th century says that if the surface is not ruled and it's of degree d, it can contain at most 11 d square lines. Okay. So if the surface is not ruled, if the zero set of the polynomial is not ruled, no problem. There are quote unquote few lines, you can handle them. I'm not going into all the details here. If the surface is singly ruled, other than those two very special surfaces I showed you, then somehow the lines contained in it do not touch each other. They kind of sweep through the surface, but they can touch each other at singular points. But singular points lie in a one-dimensional curve, and you can play. Again, it's kind of easy to handle. And doubly ruled surfaces pose no difficulty because it simply means that you have two lines through each point instead of line of one. At any rate, with some work, you can get it to work, except that what happened if your surfaces contains planes? If the zero set of the polynomial contains planes, then you are stuck. Maybe all your points lie on a plane. What do you do then? Well, then comes to the rescue the assumption that no plane contains more than square root n lines. And so if you work the bound in this case, you'll see that it does not create more than the bound that we already had before, because otherwise you're in trouble. So altogether, we get the bound that we want. So a better bound for incidences between points and lines in three dimensions than you could get in the plane. From this, it is very trivial to prove Elekesh conjecture. You just look at the points that are k rich. You lower bound this quantity by m number of points times k, because each of them touches k lines. You solve it for m, and you get exactly Elekesh bound. There are some details I'm skipping over, but OK. So again, a commercial slide. So this idea of polynomial partitioning opened up a new area where lots of problems have been solved. Incidence problems, mostly in higher dimensions, that nobody had an idea how to approach before, but also problems that can be reduced to incidences and problems that have nothing to do with incidences that I'll mention if I have time. Probably don't have time. And they really looked hopeless before, and now they are, I wouldn't call them trivial, but they are much simpler. Okay, so here come several slides where I just try to list all, not all, many of the results that have been obtained from this, in this, so to speak, fairy tale. In the interest of time, I mean, the slides are available if anyone wants to look at them. Let me kind of skip over. There are kind of lots of new results that have been obtained. Incidences, points, lines, curves, surfaces, all kinds of new bounds for distinct distances other than the one I mentioned. Something I want to try to mention, these polynomials vanishing on grids, which was a major development. Some applications of incidences, like unit area triangles and God knows what. And another batch of recent results about eliminating depth cycles in a range, in collection of lines in three dimensions, which I'll try to touch if I have time. I probably won't. Let me first talk about this problem, kind of a little easier. Distinct distances, but now under the assumption that the points lie on two lines in the plane, and the lines are neither parallel nor orthogonal, and you only look at distances between points on one line and points on another, on the other line, call it dp1, p2, and the result is that the number of these distances is at least 10 to the 4 third, assuming that the lines are not parallel nor perpendicular, much more than the lower bound of R dash, Guth, Katz, etc. So if the lines are orthogonal or parallel, you can get a linear number of distinct distances only by placing the points either equally spaced when they are parallel or square root, a distance square roots from the origin using the Pythagorean theorem. So, but if the angle is not 0 or pi over 2, then you should get more. Perdi conjectured it, Elekesh, of course, proved it, and then a year earlier improved it. And we've improved it further from 5/4 to 4/3. So it was in a paper with Sheffer and Shoimoshi, which used ad hoc fairly simple ideas. But I'm mentioning this result because it's a special case of a much more general theory of Elekesh, Ronyai, and Sabo that we worked on a couple of years ago. And the question has to do with points on a Cartesian product. So in three dimensions, you have three sets of real numbers, A, B, C. You look at the Cartesian product, A times B times C. You have a polynomial F of some constant degree. And you ask how many zeros can the polynomial have on this Cartesian product? How many points of the grid, so to speak, the zero set of the polynomial passes? Let me kind of just mention here the so-called bivariate case where the polynomial is just the graph, if you will, of a bivariate polynomial, z equal fxy. Okay, now again, if you are not careful, the number can be quadratic. It can never be more than quadratic, especially in the bivariate case, it's trivial. But it can be quadratic, for example, if the polynomial is x plus y, and you choose the right sets, or x times y, and again, you use the right sets. Then for every pair of x and y, you get a value that lies in the third set. But what Elekesh and Ronyai have shown, that these are the only two possible cases, up to some obvious transformations. What they actually showed is that if you do have a quadratically many zeros of the polynomial on the Cartesian product, then the polynomial must be of the form x plus y or x times y, maybe after a change of variables, where you replace every variable by another variable, as shown here. But all of these are polynomials. Quite an amazing result. And what we have shown is that if this is not the case, if the polynomial does not have this special form, then the number of zeros can be only n to the 11 6. This is the paper of Elekesh and Ronay. There was a subsequent paper of Elekesh and Sabo where they generalized it from the bivariate case to an arbitrary polynomial, f x, y, z equals 0. Much more complicated, similar but different characterization of when you can get quadratically many zeros. I will say nothing about it. Let me just show the connection to that problem. So, where is the polynomial? The polynomial is simply the distance, or the square of the distance. Using the law of cosines, if you call this x and this y, then the distance is simply, the square is simply x squared plus y squared plus minus 2xy cosine of theta. And now the Cartesian product is A is the set of points on L1, parameterized by the distance, B is the set of points here, and C is the set of square distances. The sets here are not of the same size, but the theorem holds here as well. And again, it's interesting that this polynomial has the special form if and only if the two lines are orthogonal or parallel. Otherwise, it does not have the special form. So you are exactly in the framework of Elekesh-Ronay. The number of zeros, we know what it is because we've chosen C to be the set of all distances. So every point in P1, every point P2 gives the distance that appears in C. So here we know the bound, but we want a lower bound on C, and we get it. We use the Elekesh-Ronay, et cetera, bound that we got, where the sets are not equal, and the bound looks something like that. 11.6 is if simply you get if you add up those three exponents. So we get this upper bound, but we know that the number of distinct distances is n squared. We solve this and get that C, the number of distinct distances, is n to the 4/3. So this is kind of a special application of this result, and there are many other applications. Main trick there is to show that the polynomial does not have the special form, which is not always a triviality. Okay, the last topic, whichever, let's see how much I can do it, is a non-incidence application of polynomial partitioning. And it almost solves a problem that has been completely stuck with basically no progress whatsoever other than formulating the question. And the question has to do with eliminating depth cycles among lines, and then among triangles, and then among algebraic curves, and then some applications. But let me just talk about the case of lines. So I am given n lines in three dimensions in general position. They are not vertical. They are not parallel. They do not touch each other. So now if I give you two lines, I can always say that one line lies below another line. There is a unique vertical line that passes through both of them, and if in this vertical line L1 touches it below L2, then L1 is smaller than L2. This is the depth relationship, and we would like to call it a depth order, depth by Z coordinate, except that it can contain cycles. That's the simplest example, and if it contains cycles, you don't like it, and you would like to break them. To break cycles, you are allowed to cut the lines at various points of your liking, and then you will get segments, rays, and maybe some lines will be left. And then you want those objects. Now the depth relation is partial because now not every pair of objects can be compared, but you want this partial relationship to be an order, to be acyclic. And the question is, how many cuts do you need to guarantee that? Quadratically, many cuts are trivial. You just cut at each point where a line passes over the other. but you want to do better. And there is basically no history or very few papers that essentially do nothing or do interesting things, but far away from solving the problem. The problem comes from some real application in computer graphics where you instead of lines, you have triangles. They are pairwise disjoint, and you want to draw the scene that the triangles induce on the screen. And the trick is to draw them from back to front, repainting each triangle, each new triangle over parts of older triangles that it hides. And you can do it as long as there is no cycle. Because if there is a cycle, the algorithm gets stuck. You will paint over something that is over something that hides it. So lines is a special case. Okay. And the observation is that you may need n to the 3 half cuts because of the joints result. Because if you take a joint, like here, and move the perturb the line slightly and choose the right point of view, so to speak, or the right direction of the z, each joint will become a small cycle. And because those cycles are so small and separate from each other, you will need to cut around each of them to eliminate all of them. So you will need n to the 3 half in the worst case because of the joints bound. Can you do it with n to the 3 half? So we were able to prove almost n to the 3 half. We still have a polylogarithmic factor, but that's considered nice. And it can be extended in various ways. Let me quickly show you how you do it. You use the polynomial partitioning. You have no incidences here because no line touches another line, but you can still use this partitioning polynomial to your advantage. And it goes like that. So remember the extension of the polynomial partitioning of Guth. So now we have lines, we don't have points, but his extension says that given n lines in 3 dimensions, we can break space into d cube, by a polynomial of degree d, we can break space into d cube cells, connected components of the complement, so that each cell is crossed by at most n over d square lines. Okay, so we are going to use that. We take such a polynomial. The degree, I'll tell you in a minute what it is, and we draw it. Now, we think of each cycle as a geometric entity, which is the green loop shown here. So we walk along each line until there is the time comes to jump up to the next line. We walk around it and jump up and walk and jump up until we complete a loop. This green loop identifies the cycle. And to get rid of the cycle, we need to make sure that we cut the green loop, but not at a vertical segment because that's useless. We have to cut the green loop at one of the segments along the lines that form the cycle. Okay. So the easy case is that we didn't cut the cycle at all. But that means that all those 3 lines passed to some subcell of the decomposition, of the partitioning, and we will handle it recursively over that, using that cell. So that's easy. The other case is that our polynomial did cut one of the lines within the green loop, but that's exactly what we want. We have eliminated the cycle. So that's good. But the interesting case is that our polynomial cuts the cycle, but only at one or several vertical jumps. But in this case, the trick is to say that when it happens and you walk along the green loop, when you go from here to here, your level goes up. There is one extra layer of the polynomial below you. Like how many times you meet the zero set of the polynomial if you go from where you are downwards. Okay, but the green loop is a closed cycle. And if the level goes up, it has to come down. Where can it come down? It cannot come down in a vertical jump because all the vertical jumps go up. The level only goes up at vertical jumps. So it has to go down either because, as before, you did cut one of the lines of the cycle, which is good, or something like this happened. In the vertical curtain below the line, the zero set somehow make a turn and the level has gone down from 2 to 0. But the number of times this can happen for a line is only this square. It's a Harnack's theorem, Bezout theorem, if you will, very easy. So you get nd square such cuts. The number of cuts here is nd. Altogether, you are down with nd square. And you get this recurrence. You have d cube subproblems. Each of them has only n over d square lines. So this is the recursive term. And outside the recursion, you only do nd square cuts. You solve it. You can choose d as large as n to the 1 quarter. And you get solution becomes n to the 3 half polylogon. Two more minutes. So let's see. I can keep on dumping on you extra stuff, which is kind of nice, but not in 2 minutes. Maybe I'll spare you and jump directly to the end. Thank you. They could have, what I can say for sure, they have been studied under different fields. Because, I mean, this is over the reals, over the complex.
Finite fields
too, yes. There are, the bound change, the argument change, obviously, polynomial partition do not hold. There is no kind of notion of kind of continuous space that you can play with. About hyperbolic planes, I'm not sure whether people did look at it. But I mean, I assume you can always reduce it to incidences of points and curves if you model lines in the hyperbolic, say, plane or something. So in this sense, it was looked at.
What about the complex field?
The complex field, so Semmered rotor, this was the real question. Can it be extended to the complex field? So there was a paper by Chaba Tot from 2003 where he proved it before the algebraic revolution. It took, I don't know, 10, 15, a lot of time for the journal to accept the paper. It was fairly complicated. But then, meanwhile, using the algebraic techniques, people have shown it. So now the bound m to the 2/3, n to the 2/3, is due to Toth originally, but now there are arguments. Essentially, it becomes a question about incidences between two-dimensional flats, planes, and points in four dimensions, in real space, if you represent complex numbers and you use certain properties. So people have looked at this problem for other curves and surfaces in the complex plane, not so much. But at least for points and lines, we know it.
Yes, so my question is related. So I know that there are some cases in which this sort of approach has had successes in confined fields, but it's harder because we don't have a topology. So I would say FK is harder than C in that sense, even. So can you give us a sense, or is it not right? You have a sense of what can be done over FT. So is it only whatever has to do with incidences, but nothing of what has to do with topology?
Yes, I mean, so I apologize that my quote-unquote expertise doesn't cover this case, but there are, in fact, there are people here in the audience who did study it. Yeah, there is no topology, and you need some other arguments. So I'm not sure what's the best answer. There are a few works that try to do, if not incidences, some related things that can be reduced to incidences distinct distances and other questions. So people did look in finite fields too. But
Any more questions or comments? Well, if not, let's thank Micha again.
Thank you.